Assalamu alaikum. Welcome to Marine Science Grade 9 Tele class. Today I am going to explain you about some marine organisms, and then I will be explaining you about some phylums. So, before we start, I just want to remind you about your attendance. You just have to click the link given here. So, now let's start the lesson. So, the previous day I have explained you about the five kingdoms. So, the kingdom Monera, Protista, Fungi, Plantae and Animalia. So, today I am going to first explain you about the bacteria and virus. The other day I already have explained you about the kingdom Monera, where these bacterias are coming. So, bacterias are microscopic unicellular organisms that belong to kingdom Monera, and they exist everywhere. So, I think now you all know that. So, today we will focus more on virus. So, unlike the bacteria, the viruses are not considered as a living thing. The other day also I told there are some reasons. So, the viruses do not have a cell structure, and they are generally many hundred of times smaller than the cell. So, in this picture also you can see this is a human cell, and here you can see a bacterial cell and a virus. So, you can compare the size of a normal cell, a bacterial cell and a virus. So, viruses are much more smaller in size compared to other cells. And then about the virus, usually the virus has only DNA or RNA material inside, and then this DNA or RNA material is enclosed by a protein envelope or a protein coat. And viruses cannot reproduce on their own. Always they need to infect a host cell if they want to replicate or if they want to reproduce. So, here I will show you a short video on virus replication.
Viruses are agents capable of infecting cells and reproducing, but it can be argued whether a virus is alive or just a complex group of molecules, since it requires a host cell in order to reproduce. Whether they are alive or not, they're able to co-opt the host cell's machinery in order to do the bidding of the virus. The replication of the genetic material of the virus, as well as the structural elements that package and protect the genetic materials and enable the virus to infect new host cells. There are many different types of viruses infecting a large range of host cells. They all follow the same general life cycle, with variations in the details of how each accomplishes its replication.
So, then I am going to move to algae and seagrass. So, the other day also I explained you some about the algae. So, algae are coming under the kingdom Protista. They are not plants. So, they are also capable of photosynthesis, but they are not coming under plants. You can see that they lack true leaves, stems, roots and the vascular system. So, here you can see some different types of algae. So, these algae do not have the true leaves or the stems, vascular system or the structures as the normal plants. And there are lots and lots of types of algae. There are red algae, there are green algae, there are brown algae, and there are microscopic algae, there are larger algae as well. Here you can see some algae. So, algae are autotrophs. I think now you all remember what is meant by autotrophs. Autotrophs are the organisms that can produce their own food. So, algae, as I have said, they range from single celled organisms to very large organisms like these kelps. These are actually the kelp forest. Kelps are the largest algae. So, they are several meters long. So, then we will move to seagrasses. So, as I have said, the seagrasses and algae are two different things. So, both the seagrass and algae able to photosynthesize. However, the seagrasses, here you can see the seagrasses, they have leaves, they have roots, they bear flowers, seeds, fruits. So, they are actually submerged plants that you find in marine environment, and nearly these are found in coastal waters, means the water that are closer to the land area. So, seagrasses are considered as plant while the algae are considered as protist. And then you can see here some seagrass beds. So, if a place is full of seagrass, then we call that area seagrass bed. Like the terrestrial grasslands, you can see in the marine environment there are some seagrass beds, and these seagrass beds are actually providing food for many marine organisms as well as some migratory birds. And here you can see food for many nearshore organisms. Nearshore organisms means the organisms that you find in the shore area, lagoon area, and then in the reef area. So, these seagrasses are actually found in shallow waters, because these are photosynthetic organisms, they cannot live in deep sea. And then the seagrasses, they are actually very helpful to us. These seagrasses will be actually trapping the sediments, and they will be taking in carbon dioxide for photosynthesis, and they will be releasing lots of oxygen, means they are helping the organism living around them, and then they are providing food for so many organisms. And here you can see some example of seagrasses like the turtle grass, eel grass, and surf grass. So, there are other varieties. Even in Maldives, you find lots and lots of seagrass beds around our islands as well.
coronavirus infection ki namuma samange fadain virus ge sabun jehe baye mi baye ki am kon fuppa me nizama ege sabun asar kura baye
and then we will move on to phylum. The other day I have explained you about the kingdom Animalia. So, the kingdom Animalia is divided into different phylums, and these phylums are divided into classes, classes into order, orders into family, then genus into species. So, today we will then focus on kingdom Animalia. So, the kingdom Animalia is divided into some major phylums by looking at their characteristic features. So, here you can see some names of the phylum. So, here you can see phylum Chordata, phylum Echinodermata, phylum Arthropoda, phylum Nematoda, phylum Annelida, phylum Mollusca, phylum Platyhelminthes, phylum Cnidaria, and phylum Porifera. In your previous textbook, you have seen all these phylums, but now in our new syllabus, some of these phylums are excluded. So, in the new syllabus, we will be looking at phylum Chordata, phylum Echinodermata, phylum Arthropoda, phylum Annelida, phylum Mollusca, and phylum Cnidaria. So, here we will go one by one into these phylum. So, let us start. So, the first phylum that I am going to explain you or the introduce you is phylum Cnidaria. So, Cnidarians means they have a sac-like body with single opening. So this opening is called the mouth, and then the mouth will be surrounded by tentacles. So this is their basic structure, and then these tentacles have small stinging cells. Means if you touch a cnidarian, then they will sting you. So that is how, that is actually one main characteristics of all cnidarians. And then here you can see, as I told you previously, the phylum Cnidaria also have different classes like Cubozoa, Scyphozoa, Entozoa and Hydrozoa. But in new syllabus, we are not looking into these class as well. We will just look at some organism. So usually in phylum Cnidaria, we will look at only the coral, but you need to know some examples. So here I have shown you some examples like box jelly, moon jelly, purple jelly, the anemone, coral, hydra and Portuguese man of war. So all these organisms, they have a sac-like body and then one opening the mouth, and the mouth will be surrounded by the tentacles, and these tentacles have the stinging cells. So if you touch any of these things, they will sting you. So then we will move into the next phylum, that is phylum Annelida. So annelids means actually the true worms. True worms means they have similar segments in their body. So all these annelids have bodies consisting of many similar segments. Their body has similar segments. If you look at all these organisms, their body have similar segments, and these are actually the true worms. So some example here, you can see the earthworm, fireworm, leeches, feather dust worms and the Christmas tree worms. And then the annelids, these are found actually in all the environment, like the marine environment, terrestrial environment, freshwater environment. So they are found in all these environment, but they are found in environment where there is water or some humidity in that environment. If there is no humidity, means it will be difficult for these annelids to survive. So here you can see some marine annelids. So in the marine environment, usually you find these annelids sheltering inside the sand sometimes, or inside the muddy areas, or others may be living inside the limestones, they may be living, burrowing inside the corals, or they may be living in between the weeds. So they get shelter from these areas. Then we will move on to phylum Mollusca. So phylum Mollusca means the organisms having a very soft body, and then some may have shell, others may not have a shell, but they usually have a muscular foot and an organ called the mantle. So all the mollusks, they are soft bodied organisms. So here you can see the phylum Mollusca. They also have different classes, but as I told you previously, now in the new syllabus, we are not going to look at different classes, but here you can see the classes of phylum Mollusca include the gastropods, bivalves and cephalopods. So these include some organisms like snail, the slugs, squid, octopus and clams, scallops, mussels. So all these organisms are having a very soft body inside the shell or without the shell. So here you can see the snail and conus. So these organisms, they usually have a distinct eyes, and then they have tentacles. And not all of them are very dangerous, but some are dangerous. Here you can see one conus. This is actually one deadly conus. So if they sting us or if they attack us, even we will die. There are very harmful conus living in the marine environment. So usually by looking at the beautiful pattern and the bright colors, usually is a warning mask. They are telling that we are dangerous. So in marine environment, usually if an organism is very bright, means usually they are dangerous. And then here you can see some other mollusk. Previously you have seen the mollusk with one shell. So here I am showing you some with two shells. So clams and oysters, they have two shells, but the two shells are hinged together. Like the door hinges, they also have a hing, mean they can open and close. So these are more examples of mollusks. So they also have a very soft body inside these shells. So here you can see an oyster, the clam, and then the something which is common among the our reefs, that is the giant clam. So giant clams, the normal clams, all these are also coming under phylum Mollusca. And then there are organisms without external shell as well. So these organisms include the octopus, squid, and then the cuttlefish. So these are also some organisms that belong to phylum Mollusca. They also have a very soft body, but they have actually a head with a crown, and the crown is with the tentacles. And here you can see they have a very complex and a very large eye. Usually these are the organisms having the largest eyes in the marine environment. So that's all, and tomorrow, the next class, we will be continuing the phylums.